Pranams to everybody. Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. I'm going to be very short because I know we are running late. So I am a student of Pooja Swami Dayananda Saraswati Ji of Arshavidya Parampara. And currently I'm in Arshavidya Gurukulam Anaikatti doing a 108-day course on Bhagavad Gita. But I live in the US, hopefully not for very long. I'll be back soon. And this is part of my, This is part of my internship that I did, Masters in International Education in George Washington University. And the internship I did was with Arshavidya Gurukulam, Salisbury, Pennsylvania. What I'm trying to propose, both in the paper and what I noticed, was every class that we took in GW, they would enforce how sustainable developmental goals are very important, UNESCO's SDGs. So they're all into SDGs. Everything in the world now is SDG, and that's how they put their money, depending on, you know, which SDG you're trying to fulfill. So then when I studied them, whatever class I was taking, I was like, all this is followed. If you lead a proper Vaidika lifestyle, we probably fulfill all the 17 SDGs and more. And having lived in Anaikatti before in Arshavidya Gurukulam in 2012 when Pooja Swamiji was in his physical body before his Mahasamadhi, I was like, we do this and more. And I'm sure it's the same for Chinmaya CVV and SIF also. So any institution, a modern institution which teaches Vedanta, Advaita Vedanta in the traditional paddhati, definitely fulfills these. My paper is, of course, a very cursory look, my lived experience. It's not a very in-depth analysis. And all this is something that we're all aware of. And all of you esteemed speakers more than me, Bharat Gupji and all are here. So I'm sure there's more research to be done. But I will just quickly go through what I noticed. And I will just give the points so we don't have to go in depth. But I'm happy to send it to anybody who wants a soft copy. So we'll go to the 14th page where I started off comparing it. This is all, and this is all geared towards a very American professor who was very kind enough to accept it because I had to put it in a language she accepted and understood. So it's all a very towards a Western viewpoint, and I think that's also something we should be doing. I was happy to do that, but it's not how I usually think. I think very Arshavidya-like. So let's see if that's the page. No. Yes. So if you look at this, I try to show that UNESCO has 17 SDGs, and through our Vedanta or Advaita teaching, we have, what I noticed was 12 out of 17 of them are being followed. And how is that? This is the main graph. And we can go one by one very quickly, and we can either be interactive, that could be quicker. Initially, I'll just call it out, and then we can just look at each of them in our own, how we understand it. So they say SDG 2 is zero hunger. And we know what that is. You know, Purnatvam we come from, Annapurna Devi, we have a whole goddess who is dedicated to bhojanam and annam and everything. And us feeding, whether it's in the mathas or anakshetras or like Kali Kamri Baba who gives bhiksha, like our concept of bhiksha or dhanam or whatever. So all that is fulfilled, and I focused on Arshavidya Gurukulam, Pennsylvania, but this can be, we can transport that to any institution. So yes, so I talk about how this is a concept that is very Vaidika in nature, that feeding people every day, of course. I mean, everything follows the Panchamahayagna. So the camp that I was a part of, as part of my internship in Salisbury, Arshavidya, the camp, the topic was Panchamahayagna. So we were using that Panchamahayagna concept for teaching teens who are second generation, you know, American, Indian American kids, games, everything was Panchamahayagna based. So I go from that viewpoint. Then good health and well-being, we know about that. So I'm being very quick, but like I said, I can send it to anybody. So yoga is part of now, of course, the UN, but Ministry of Ayush, that, you know, it's all the governmental level. But in our own level, if we do sadhana, and I had to map it with Kolb's experiential learning, because I have to prove it to a Western audience that what we are doing is not theory, it's experiential. Sadhana, I mean, they call it experiential learning. So I had to put that together, but I thought that was also essential because she had no idea that we do something like this. So international education, I try to say this is the indigenous knowledge systems, and it's still existent all over the country. And we, this sadhana, what we do for good health and well-being is whatever it is, whether it's japa or the learning itself or yoga or whatever. Quality education, this is the core of what I was talking about, what we learn. And we all know about Dharampalji's beautiful tree, and we know about how Indian education system was massacred by the English Education Act. And prior to that, we had this kind of education that Arshavidya and CVV offer. And we learn critical thinking. So that's become a catchphrase in the West now, critical thinking, mindfulness and all that. But that's what we do with Shravana Manana Nididhyasanam. So removing doubts or staying in that oneness and all that, that is a part of what we do. So all that, and I've mentioned the various books by Dhananda Swamiji, socio-emotional learning skills, ethical learning, moral values, these are all part of our learning and also Vriddha Vyavahara. We see and learn, you know, it's not, and through our stories, storytelling, Mahabharata, Purana, because that has a long-term effect than just giving speeches like right now I'm doing. So, and then gender equality, of course, the very idea then for Advaita Vedanta, when we're saying everything is Brahman and there's no, where is a concept of gender there? But even then we have the divine feminine, we have Navaratras, we have Devi worship. So the whole idea that we have to atomize something is moot. So we don't do that. And in oneness, we don't have to have that. And Pooja Swamiji would say, if we fulfill our duties, somebody else's rights are fulfilled. So things like that. So it's very simplistic for an Indian audience, I think, but then especially audience like you. But for a Westerner professor who's quite a huge professor, she was like, oh, wow. So she was quite amazed that there was something already like this. You know. So I just tried to map it and I didn't see any other study like this. So I thought I'll propose this. And then reducing inequality. Again, when you're saying from a paramarthika level that everything is Brahman, so even if there's a financial difference, the respect you accord the other as you are tatvamasi or you are the same as me is obviously reducing the inequality. So I go from there and I quote various scriptures which reinforce that. And also the idea that we come from a sense of plenty. So in Arshavidya Parampara, they emphasize that Satchit Ananda, Ananda Swarupa is not as bliss, though I did write that for her sake. We emphasize Ananda as fullness and Purnatvam, more than bliss. So we come from that point of view. Sustainable cities, again Panchamahayagna being a contributor. So I don't have to go into details. So if we do Panchamahayagna on a daily basis, each person does that, we wouldn't have the kind of, you know, the having to be told that we have to be sustainable. The idea itself of Panchamahayagna is to be a contributor and to be sustainable, whether in a community or on a large scale. So I just spelt it out for her, you know, for the professor and for the Western audience. And yeah, and then responsible. So SDG is Sustainable Developmental Goals. So 12, 13 different ones that I was trying to map. Responsible consumption. So when we think of Bhagwan as both the Nibbata and Upadana Karanam, transcendent and immanent, then everything is Bhagwan. So if I'm touching this, if I hit my foot, I do this. I mean, we do that for Saraswati or Lakshmi or whatever. We are so particular. For Jalam, we have a shlokam. For Agni, we have a shlokam. Deepam, we have a shlokam. Everything, morning to evening, if you continue, like how Pooja Swami taught us, we get up from the time we open our eyes till we sleep, there is a shlokam and stotram and something for every little thing. So if you're living a life, which is so you a spiritual life, and you're living a very sensitized life, then all this is sacred ecology, sacred, everything is sacred and sacrosanct. So then your consumption is very conscious. You're very conscious about what you're doing. I quoted scriptures, which all of us are aware of. Climate action, we all know that again. Vegetarianism, beef, footprint, carbon footprint, all that. So I mentioned that. And recently there was Burger King came up with something called the Impossible Whopper, which actually is a vegetarian. And then they didn't have a footfall for a long time. You know, they were going like down in their finances. And they introduced this, and I quote the numbers. It just shot up, you know. So especially in the West, there is a whole group of people who are into vegetarianism, which is a good thing. But unfortunately, here it's the reverse. Hyderabad, where I'm from, it's just much more, I see in Sainikpuri, much more non-veg joints and shawarma joints and all that. It's very unfortunate. Whereas it's going down in the West, at least in certain level of consumption. Yes, river goddesses. This is my favorite thing because it's amazing that Ganga Stotram, I'm assuming, is Shankaracharya's. He wrote it, and then Gangaji is somewhere in the north, and everywhere we chant, Salisburg we chant, there is no river there at all, and we're doing, oh, Jai Ma Gange, and it's so amazing that you're just living the fact that she's right in front of you, just embodying her wherever you are. So this is so beautiful. So when you're talking about water and water forms, so it's a very, for me, a very non-livable fact, that a theoretical fact that a Westerner is proposing. Whereas somebody who is living a Vaidika life and imbibing that in the day-to-day life. Gangaji is a reality every evening when you do the Ganga Stotram, whether in Chinmay or Arshavidya or anywhere. And then because of the projects, Namami Ganga or Clean Ganga, you have the river dolphins coming back into life, and that is part of what the SDGs propose, UNESCO proposes, life, the water life, you know, the water bodies. And Gangaji writes the Makara. So, you know, we've thought of it. I mean, the rishis, I'm in the parampara. So we've already thought of it. It's already there, you know. So I'm just putting it out. And of course, life on land, so Bhudevi, we start off with thinking of as a Bhudevi, which touch our, you know, when we put our feet on the ground, we do namaste to her. When we dance, you know, we do namaste Bhumi Puja, when we do construction. And then peace and justice, of course, we have Ahimsa as a core concept of all our actions. And we have Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha. So we start off with peace and justice as our motto in our shlokas, stotrams and everything. And then partnerships and goals is the final one, the 12 that I found the linkages. When, for example, Indica and CV, we have partnered. So if we have a common goal, which I'm saying is Advaita, or, you know, our spiritual goal, then partnerships are very common. In the internship I did in Salesburg, there also they invited psychologists and yoga teachers and others who practice this. And it was easy to see that there were no ego hassles because a goal is common. So I'm just saying that there were 12 commonalities that I encountered, and that's that. So 12 commonalities between the 17 SDGs and the 12 formats that we did in Arshavidya, which is common to Chinmay also, I'm sure. But if we probe further and we look at a proper Vaidika's life, I'm saying that not just the 17 SDGs, but probably more. A Vaidika does more for the world and sustainable development than what the UNESCO proposes. Dhanyavad. Thank you. Yes.
Which are the five remaining one which are not?
That's a good question. I should have had a graph in this. I can Google it and send it to you. I think I put it somewhere separately, not in this.
And yeah. did you had some kind of allegation, something like it should be a secular mode when you submit to the?
No. People? So the thing is, in the West where I live, and I've taught Indian language and culture at the State Department to Americans coming to India, if you put it in a language that it's understandable to them. Like they say oneness. Oneness is a Western term. So if you say oneness, wholeness, well-being, and if you put it in a format that it's good for the planet Earth and sacred ecology, there's certain terms. So if you put it in those terms, they won't, you know?
But you used some slokas.
That is fine.
So that, no.
No, so that's what I'm saying. It's very amazing that if you stand your ground and you explain why you're doing something, and you have to say it's for everybody. The slokas are Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina. So I translated. So I said it's for everybody. You have to bring in the gender element. Oh, you know, we worship the divine, which is true. We worship the divine, the feminine. So if you have your boxes checked and you know which boxes to check and which words to use in their language, then it's fine. There is a lot of Hindu phobia for sure. Like for Shivaratri, I said, let's do this. And it was all the Indians, by the way, the Indian kids who've gone from here. They said, oh, no, ma'am, it's, you know, we invite everybody. Because I see the Sikh community or the Muslim community having so many events, but we can't have a Hindu event. They wouldn't let me do a Aarti or a Puja for Shivaratri. The Indian students, the council or the association. Yes, so the phobia lies among our own children and kids, you know, the youngsters. Mm. Not from their side, if we actually put it across in the right way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
In my experience, it could be different.
Sustainable development.
So definitely Pitrikarma and Tarpanam is in sustainable development. I can relate it, but they won't understand it. Panchamahayagna, I just said to our ancestors and rishis, but they don't understand the concept because it's a very rational thinking. They do not acknowledge the existence of devatas or deities or anything that is not rational. But by saying that we observe these, I can say that it's a continuation of traditions. They understand elders because natives have elders tradition. So you can say that you're respecting your elders, which also means pitris. So you say elder traditions, we acknowledge their whatever they've given us. So if you talk in terms of we respect the tradition, the elders, what has been given to us from the previous generations, they understand. But if you say tarpanam and we're giving it to the pitris, there's no understanding because their minds don't go beyond what they see. So it's a very rational world there. So unfortunate, but dhanyavad. Thank you.